ADHD is not just about behavioral symptoms like impulsivity or hyperactivity or difficulty concentrating. That being true, then what are the medical and biological causes of ADHD? And stay tuned to the end of the video where I share three misconceptions that are being just accepted as fact. Today we're going to talk about the causes of ADHD. I'm Angela Howard, and I am passionate about breaking the stigma of mental illness among fellow Christians. I'm here to help you live a more purposeful life in your relationship with God and with one another. In 2013, the CDC released a report stating that 11% of children from the ages of 4 to 17 had been diagnosed with ADHD at some point in their lives. It's a neurological disorder with a genetic basis. It affects the frontal lobes of our brains, and this is where we make our decisions. It really impacts our executive functioning. Executive functions that are affected by ADHD are things like planning and organizing, sequencing, processing information and making decisions, planning ahead, mood regulation, and even things like learning from mistakes and consequences. And the results from things like this show up in forgetfulness and a difficulty getting motivated and a tendency to lose things. You might see people interrupting others or hyper-focusing, and also you're going to find a lot of mood swings. This all has to do with that biological basis of our frontal lobes not functioning the same way that people do who do not have ADHD. I can give you some examples from my house. I live with three people who have ADHD, and when I asked my children how they were affected by it, this is what they said. Emily, who's 16, my daughter, said that she definitely has difficulty processing information. There are times where she might be in a room or just hanging out with friends, and she doesn't notice tension in the room. She might say something that might upset someone, and she doesn't realize it. She doesn't feel that same sense that other people will pick up on. There are times that she does, but a lot of times she doesn't pick up on it. Another thing that she struggles with is really that, I would say, the multiple instructions area. So this happens a lot at school, where a teacher will give a list of instructions, and Emily described it like this. She'll just kind of tune that out and then maybe hyper-focus on one thing that she knows that she needs to do. And it might not even have to do with that classroom assignment, and it might be about a whole nother class. And so it might look like she's disinterested or even disrespectful, but that's not how she intends it. It's how she's able to function in kind of, to her, a chaotic environment. And so she might go back to that assignment later and address it when she's at home in her room where it's quiet. But that's how she's able to get through it and kind of get around those difficulties. For my son, Ben, he struggles with getting motivated to get things done. And so what he's realized is that he needs a hard deadline for things. He needs to know when something is going to get done, and so that he will be able to motivate himself, because he knows what the consequences are if he doesn't get it done. And so those are a couple of examples of what it looks like at our house. Three misconceptions about ADHD that seem to be thrown around like it's a fact are: you have it because you lack self-discipline and are not motivated at all. And number two, you have it from a poor diet. Or number three, you have it from bad parenting. I think that the key to understanding ADHD is that it's neurodevelopmental. It is not about trying harder to do better. As someone who doesn't have it and is living with family members who do, I see how difficult it is for their lives. Sometimes it's just heartbreaking to see how it's impacting them. But I also see them finding a way around the difficulties that it presents. And I see them become successful and pushing forward in their lives. I think that they are amazing, and they're creative and intuitive and brilliant. And we need to remember the strengths that our loved ones have, even when they're coming up against things that are difficult. I also want us to remember what it says in Colossians 3:12. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. This is what we all need to do for one another. How does ADHD affect your everyday life? I'd love to hear from you. So comment in the comments below so that we can connect. And please subscribe for more videos. I'll be sharing some great tips and resources whether you yourself have a mental illness or have a loved one who does. A big thank you to Dr. Stephen Huggins, who was an incredible help for putting together this video and provided some great research on ADHD. Just want to thank him for all that he did.